So, good day everyone, and welcome to this webinar. We are presenting the beta program of WebRatio 9, the new version of WebRatio platform, which introduces many new features. So, I'm Roberto Cerbis, the CIO of WebRatio, and here with me there is Michela Frigerio, our head of training and customer support. Michela will take care of showing us the new platform by realizing a fully functional web application from scratch using the WebRatio low-code method. So we have many things to show in the agenda, both in the development environment, like the new editor for the user interface, and also in the execution environment with the new architecture based on the microservices and single page application and so on. The time available is not so much, so today you will have the possibility to see an overview that will be followed in the next weeks by other more specific in-depth moments. Before I give the token to Michela, you will have the chance to ask some questions. You can use the chat tool of the webinar tool to post your question, and we will summarize them at the end of the demo, and we will try to answer to you, or otherwise we'll answer by email. So I give the floor to Michela for the demo. The demo will take about 20 minutes. And let's go. Thanks.
Thanks, Roberto. Hi, everyone. In this demo, we will see the modeling of our web application, which is the customer management. So let's get started. First of all, we start creating the project containing all the features of the application, which is a web project. And after that, we are going to add the very first page of the application, and we will show a message to the user giving him the welcome. So we will go in the first web view, which is the container of a specific user role, and it contains all the user interaction. So let's add the home page. And the very first content, which is a message. You can give name to the components, and let's write the message, which is the user welcome. After that, we can take care of the user interface, switching to the dedicated view, which is the layout view. Here you get what you get editor showing you the preview of the real page on the right, and on the left a toolbar showing you a list of widgets that you can use to create the user interface. So we can select the widget we want to use to show the message, for example the alert one, and with a double click we can configure the widget properties. The first properties we are going to set is the one that connects the message shown by the alert widget to the message of the component we just added on the home page. After that, we can already test the application using a command, which is the generate and run one. This command translates all the model that we created in the project in the code necessary to get a working web application. After that, the tool also starts the predefined container, which has been set during the installation phase of the platform, and also starts the predefined browser of the workstation, so that the user can easily test the web application once the process has been completed. While we are waiting for this operation to complete, let's see a feature, an interesting feature of the presentation editor, which is the chance to preview the page in different sizes to address different screens. For example, you can switch to the tablet and also to the phone. This is very interesting since you can anticipate graphic issues without looking at the final application. The project uses a standard style which contains all the widgets you can find interesting in building a web application. And it is a style based on the material design, so it follows all these kind of rules. And there will be a chance in the general availability release to create your own styles and so add your own widgets to the toolbar of the presentation editor. As you can see, the application is now loading into the browser because what you are getting here is a single page application. And so the application at the start must be loaded inside the browser. And as you can see, we are seeing the message modeled in the page. Now let's add some data to this application. For example, the data regarding the customers. Web Ratio platform centralizes the data management in a dedicated project, which is the data service project. So let's create this kind of project. And in this project, what we have to do is to define the structure of the managed information in terms of a UML class diagram. Let's suppose that we already have a data source containing the customer's information. So we want to connect to this data source and we just have to configure some properties to be able to connect to this data source. So I'm writing also the username and the password. After that, I can use a feature which is the synchronization, which connects to the data source and makes a comparison between the content of the class diagram in your project and the content of the data source. And we can make different actions. Right now, we are interested in importing all the information stored in the data source inside the model. So I can say to the tool to import everything. And what we get is that the tool automatically creates for me the classes representing the information stored in the data source. If it's necessary, you can add other details to the information. For example, we can set that the logo, it's not a simple string, but it's a file, the image of the customer. What we have to do now is to publish this information so that the web application and the web project can use it. This is very simple. You just have to switch to the class services item and open a dialog, which allows you to choose to publish among to the read, create, update, and delete operation. So you can, for example, switch on the customer and the industry type classes. This setting adds information in our model. So what's next is to repeat the synchronization procedure. And what we are going to do now is the opposite operation, which is the creation of all the model elements into the data source. And this is accomplished by the tool directly, creating all the necessary code. So at the end of this procedure, our data source will contain a set of tables and columns representing the class diagram we have here. And that's it. Another feature is the chance to create your own information. What I mean is that these are predefined services having a predefined structure, but maybe you want to aggregate some information and publish them in a single service. And this can be done using another section of the project, which is the creation of action definitions. And these actions can also contain business logic. And for example, we are going to create an action for saving the customer. Action definitions have a predefined structure composed by an entry point and two exit points for the success and the error results. And what you can design here is the business logic of your service. And let's say that we want to create a customer. So let's place a create operation and let's configure it to create a customer. So using this data binding property, I can choose between all the classes included in the class diagram. So I can say that I want to create a customer. Then I can customize the entry point, adding the information necessary to the create operation to work properly. And using a wizard, I can select which are the information I want to provide. For example, the name and the industry type. This information that are named parameter have a name and also a type, but you can also add validation rules to these parameters so that when the service is called, the information received are checked and you are sure that the operation will succeed. Now, once the action definition is complete, you may want to publish it as we did for the class services. And it's very simple. You just have to switch it on in the dedicated section about the action services. And as you can see here, you can switch the operation on for a dedicated role. This is very interesting. You can model roles inside the project and you can switch on and off services for a specific user role. After that, what we have to do is to generate the project. And as for the web project, what the tool is doing here is to generate all the code necessary to get the application up and running. In this case, we are obtaining an application that publishes REST web services. The main page of this application is a page documenting all the web services that you added to the project. And also this page allows you to test directly these services without having a client application. So it's very interesting. And the application contains a set of services for managing the user authentication, even though we didn't model them explicitly. So these services are present by default and lets you manage identities, applications, and user logins and logout, and are based on the OAuth 2 standard. So giving a look at the page, you can see that there is a class services section with the services that we switched on, and also an action services section with the action definition we modeled, and the authentication services section for services dedicated to the user authorization. Now let's go back to our web project and use these services for modeling content on our application. For example, let's add on the home page the list of customers. Let's place the list component. And as we did for the create operation, we can set the data binding to use a specific service. And for this purpose, we need to have a data service project connected to this one. So this is why the tool is asking us to select one of this kind of project. Let me select the one I created before. And you can see here that you see the list of services published by the data service project, and I'm interested in the customer one, so I select it. And also you can select which are the information that must be shown to the user in this specific list. So let's say the name, the industry type, and the logo. And it's also possible to sort the list using one of the published information. Now, we need to add another piece of model which allows the user to log in, since the web services are under access rights. So user must be authorized to see this kind of information. And this let me show you another feature of the platform, which is the chance to add predefined patterns to the model. And in this case, we are using the login pattern, which creates for you the model necessary to log in and also for changing the password, because the application already contains a set of features that handle password expiration. Now, what we need to do is to switch to the layout view and add the user interface for the list. So let's select the data grid widget, for example, which basically is a table. And with a double click, let's connect this element to the list we created before. So we must set the rows property, which specifies that the number of rows are the customers, and that the columns are the attributes we chosen to be shown in the list. This prepares for us some additional places where we can add other widgets that say the specifies the user interface for the specific information. For example, we can add a text for writing the attribute label, the title of the attribute, and we can also add other widgets for handling the values of the table. For example, we can use the image widget for the logo. And as you can see, in some cases, when the widget, the container widget has a context, the inner widget is able to inherit some properties by default. So let's complete this widget, adding the text for showing the attribute value instead for the name and the industry type. And then what we have to do is to generate the project to test the feature. When the process is complete, we will need to reload the application on the browser, since it's a single page application. And differently from the previous navigation, the user will not see directly the home page, but it will be automatically redirected to the login page, since it needs to provide credentials. And the generation process automatically creates for you also user for test purposes, so that we can easily start navigating our application without doing anything else. This is the default login page. As you can see, we have a custom, a standard graphic here, but you can in any moment customize it. And if the login is successful, you can see that we are looking at the home page. And as you can see, there was a moment in which the data were not present because the application was retrieving the data directly from the backend. And this is the list of customers. So now let's add another feature to this page, which is the search, the customer search. So let's add a component able to define a form for adding the search criteria. And then let's add a couple of search criteria, for example, the name field and a selection field for choosing from a list, the industry type. Once we confirm, we can see the list of fields directly in the outline view, which is a tree representation of the model. And we need to configure the selection field about the industry type to state where, which are the options of the selection field. And we can use a property similar to the one shown for the list, and we can select the service about the industry type. Then we can select the attribute shown and also how the list should be sorted. Now we have to use to add in the model a new concept, which is the concept of the user interaction. So basically, where the user interacts to the application to start the search, and this is represented by an event that triggers what we call a navigation flow, which is this arrow here. Let's name the event search, and the navigation flow targets the list because the list will accept the search criteria and filter its own results. So let's configure further the list, adding some conditions that will enable the list to accept the search criteria. So let's add one condition for each criteria. So a condition for the name attribute. You can set which is the predicate you want to use to compare the provided value. And you have to set the required property to false so that the user can decide whether to search using the name field, the industry type field of both or both of them. Let's add the other condition about the industry type. And to complete the feature, we must pass the search criteria written by the user in the form to the list. And this is done making a binding on the navigation flow, where I can set that the industry type field must bind the industry type condition, and the name field the name condition. The feature is now complete, and as we did before, we have to switch to the layout view and add widgets for the fields. What I'm doing here now is to select the widget for the grid and enable the filtering feature of the widget, which basically will add a new row on the table where I can place widgets about field controls. So let's select, for example, the input widget for the name criteria and place it inside the row. And what I need to do here is to choose a field of the form that we have modeled before. So for example, the name field. And we can also set some designing configuration. So for example, I can switch the label off since we already have the label of the column in the table. And I can choose another widget for the industry type, for example, the auto completion. And in a similar way, I can set the field, which is the industry type 1. And also in this case, I can switch the label off. The last element we need is the widget for triggering the search, which is the search button. And the idea is always the same. We have to attach an element of the model. So let's select the search event. And then let's generate the page where we worked. So the tool also allows you to generate a portion of the project and not all the project anytime you change something. And as we did before, at the end of the process, we have to reload the application to get to see the new feature. The user will not be forced to log in another time because it already gets a token which is valid for an hour. So the result is that we are still in the home page seeing the search criteria. So we can start filtering using the name, and then we can start writing something, for example, in the auto-completion. And that's it. Now let's see the last feature of this demo, which is the chance to create a new customer. So let's add a new page at this purpose, the customer management page, and let's model the form containing the fields for saving the customer. And supposing that we want to use the same fields of the search, we can just copy and paste the form in the new page, changing the name into customer info. And then we need to add here the business logic that it's able to save the customer. So now it's time to use the custom service we modeled previously in the data service project. And for this purpose, we add an action and we connect it to the save customer services. Now we need to add the interaction point. So we add an event with its navigation flow and we name it save. And the action here automatically configure itself so that it's able to receive the parameters we modeled on the action definition. So we are able here to make the binding as we did for the search, but now we can bind the industry type with the parameter of the action industry type and the name field with the parameter name. What we have to do now is to specify where the user will be redirected when the business logic ends. And this can be done for the success result, for example, going back to the home page, and for the error result, for example, remaining in the customer management page. Now let's add to the home page another event that allows us to reach the customer management page, and let's name it new. Okay. Of course, on forms, it's possible to add validation rules. So let's add, for example, on the name field, a validation rule stating that the name is mandatory. The last step is, as always, to model the user interface. So let's switch to the layout view. And in the new page, Customer Management, we have to add widgets for the form. So let's use a container like a card, and then let's add our widget, for example, the input widget for the name field, selecting the name field of the form. And this time for the industry type, we can use a select widget, which is basically a drop-down, selecting here that we want to bind it to the industry type field. And let's add the save button for confirming the operation. And let's select the save event here. Now we have to add also the user interface about the new event in the home page. So let's select the home page. And we are going to add this button on the top of the table, for example, using the same button widget that we used for the saving. Okay, and let's select the new event of the search form. Now we can test our feature generating the project. And at the end of the process, another time, we have to reload the application. And we are going to test the creation of the customer. Okay, let's take a look also at the address bar here, which now states that we are in the home page. And when we press the new button, as you can see, the address changes, showing us that we are in the customer management page. This is another feature of the tool, which it's able to automatically decorate the URL of the application. But even if the URL is changing, the page does not reload entirely because we are in a single page application, but only the section about the content loads the new content. So let's add, for example, the WebRatio company, and let's save it. And as you can see, we go back into the home page, and there is the new company here. And as you can see, there are also a standard image anytime a logo is not present for the company. And this is also a standard feature of the style. With this feature, the presentation of WebRatio Platform 9 beta is completed. Now I give the token back to Roberto for the questions and answers.
Good. So thank you, Michela, for the demo. As you see, there are a lot of new things and many other you have not the chance to see because time is very short. Anyway, we received some questions we'd like to answer. First of all, people are asking more details about the beta program. So beta program will begin next Monday, 11th of November. For people that subscribed to the beta program. If you didn't subscribe and you want to subscribe, just send an email to betaprogram@webratio.com. So people who subscribed will receive on Monday an email with all the details about serial number and a link to download the installation and so on. Not all the subscribers will immediately receive the chance to use the beta. Since we received many subscriptions, we will invite first only some people, and the other one will be invited in next weeks. The next question, maybe Michela could help me to ask. They are asking if the next version, well, this version, is supporting PostgreSQL 12 as a database system.
Yes, of course. We took the chance of this version to upgrade also the list of supported data sources. So you will find the newest version of the major vendors, and the list contains all the vendors that have a version that is supported by them. So the older one are not here anymore.
Okay, so another question is about migrations. I think I can answer to this question. The answer is yes, we will support migration from version 7 and 8 to WebRatio 9. The migration will not be available from the first general availability version that will be targeted only to new developments, but we will release migration in a following WebRatio version, maybe version 9.1. Someone is asking something about the source code and programming languages, and I think you are guys interested to which is the architecture behind the new platform. Let's say that on the server side, Michela, I will answer. You understand? From the server side, the technology is Java based. And microservices built around Spring and Spring Boot and so on. REST APIs, as Michela said. From the client front-end side, the main technology behind that is Angular. And we are using TypeScript to program all this stuff. And what else? The mobile, nobody is asking about the mobile, but the mobile is coming with the WebRatio 9 in the next releases of the beta, and the architecture will be the same based on Angular, same. We have time for, I think, another question, I think, that is, yeah, someone is asking how do we customize the look and feel of the application? So maybe Michela, you can answer to that question.
Yes, in the beta version, there will be not the chance to create your own style, but in the general availability, of course, there will be. And you basically will create a web style project where you can create or your own CSS rules for just changing the way the present widget look like. And you can also create your own widgets based on the Angular library that you want to include inside the tool.
Very good. So I think the time is end, so it's time to say goodbye. If you want to post more questions, you can contact Michela directly or contact the company at contact@webratio.com. If you want to participate in the beta program, just send an email to betaprogram@webratio.com. And hope to see you soon, hear you soon. Thank you for participating in the webinar. Bye bye.